Hello, church family and loved ones. Good morning, happy Sabbath. I like to sing one of my favorite songs, 343 in the blue hymnal. If you want to join along with me, help. If you would come in at the end of each chorus verse, you come in and do the start off the refrain for me, if you would. 343, I will sing of my Redeemer. Sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me on the cruel cross he suffered from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing, my Redeemer, and with his blood he purchased me, and on the cross sealed my pardon. He paid the debt and made us free. I will tell the wondrous story, how my lost state to save in his boundless love and mercy, he ransom freely gave. Oh, sing, oh, sing, of my Redeemer. And with his blood he purchased me, and on the cross he sealed our pardon. He paid the debt and set us free. I will sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love for me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God with him to be. Oh, sing, oh, sing of my Redeemer, and with his blood he purchased me, and on the cross he sealed our pardon. He paid the debt and set us free.
This past week, I was aware that I've been needing to get a little more exercise than I've been doing. And I spend an awful lot of time, you know, working at a computer editing. And after a while, you just kind of feel like you're stiff. And I got a phone call from my sister. And so I hooked up my earbuds, plugged it into my phone. And I said, let's take a walk. And we had quite a bit to talk about, and so we just walked and walked and walked. Well, she didn't, I did. And I think I must have walked 3 or 4 miles. But I'm not quite sure, because it was just so delightful just talking with her while I was walking. You run into people doing that, haven't you? Although they may not even see it, you hear them, you think they're talking to you, and they've got telephone in their ear, you know? Well, I started thinking, you know, that can be how it is with us when we pray. that we can have real conversations with God all through the day about the different things that we go through. That's what we want to study today, about real prayers. You know, when I was a kid, I saw people praying in the church, and I thought I needed to learn how to pray like they did. And so prayer was basically kind of collecting the things that people would say in prayer and then putting them in my prayer. You know, so as back in the day, you know, we used to pray to bless the call porters and missionaries. Remember that, some of you? Bless the call porters and missionaries. And a few years later, I heard the phrase, and give us traveling mercies. Never heard that phrase before. Traveling mercies, you know. And there are a lot of little expressions, you know, so I'd start tucking those in my prayers, and I thought that was what praying was about. In my teen years, something kind of went through the youth culture, and it affected others as well, and they called it conversational prayer. Did anybody remember conversational prayer? And we would get together in a small group and pray, and you weren't, not any one person was leading the prayer. You just spoke when it was your, when you felt like praying. Sometimes they would do it in a line, you know, and nobody was supposed to put the amen to the prayer until it was done. So that just as you thought of something that was on your heart, that you would mention that in prayer. And prayer then became something very different. And then a friend of mine, who I had known a few years before, wrote a letter and was talking about how they had moved to California, and she was talking about these beautiful California poppies that they had there, and taking a walk there and imagining that she was holding Jesus' hand as she took a walk and just talked with him as she walked. And I thought, that sounds like a good idea. So I tried that myself, and I remember vividly walking along a sidewalk, imagining that Jesus was right there beside me, and I was talking to him, and the conversation was very different from the prayers that I had grown up praying. We want to talk about real prayers, prayers that come from deep inside. There are some expressions that we need to think about. He who numbers the hairs of your head is not indifferent to the wants of his children. I think there's another picture I wanted to put there. We need to naturally turn to him in prayer, just like those sunflowers naturally just turn to the sun. It can be so for us. Romans 8:32 says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? If we realize how much God was willing to give, then we won't be so hesitant in praying. Now, I know that sometimes we've had some hesitation for different reasons. I was talking with my sister, talking with my mom this week, you know, kind of looking back in the past, and we're actually kind of reviewing some ancient history, but had to do with my dad. And I realized early on that my relationship with my dad and being afraid to ask him for stuff made me afraid to ask God for things too. And that's just one example of things that can affect us so that we don't really realize that God wants to have us come to him and open our hearts to him and tell him what's really there. Notice what Jesus said in Mark 11:24. What things soever ye desire when ye pray, believe that ye receive them and ye shall have them. Do we really believe that? That we can actually tell him what we really need and expect that he will give us what we need. The background slide, background to this slide is a key in the hand. And some of you will remember that really nice quotation that says, prayer is the key in the hand of faith that unlocks heaven's storehouse. There's a Bible verse that says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. You remember the Old Testament, God said in the Psalms, I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. In other words, everything is his. If we have needs, we need to set it before him. And he will answer our prayers. But he will answer our prayers in a very special way. Now, how many of you can tell me what the golden rule is? What is the golden rule? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So there's a golden rule that tells us that we should treat people the way we want to be treated, right? Of course, you know, there has been an upgrade to this golden rule. Did you know that? There's an upgrade to it. What? That's the verse, yeah. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. So you want to be treated right, you treat others right. That's the golden rule, but there's an upgrade to the golden rule. David?
And that goes like this. Do unto others before they do it unto you.
Oh, no. No, that wouldn't be an upgrade. Yeah. No. The upgrade is the platinum rule. And the platinum rule says, do unto others as they would have you do to them. You see, sometimes we want, you know, something. I think of that little Boy Scout that was dragging the lady across the street, and she said, but I don't want to go across the street, you know. you know, we do unto others. Sometimes the things that we would want is not necessarily what the other person wants. And so the truly gracious person figures out what the other person needs, what the other person likes. Well, I had my wife look this up, and on the scale of precious metals, there's gold, there's platinum, and then there's a metal that's even more precious than platinum. And I want to tell you about that today in terms of prayer. Do you know what is more precious than platinum? Rhodium. You may never have even heard of rhodium. But I'm going to tell you the rhodium rule, which goes above the do unto others as you would have them do unto others as they would have you do to them. And this is the rhodium rule is what God applies when we pray to him. Do unto others what they would ask you to do if they had the wisdom to ask for it. That's the rhodium rule. God does for us beyond what we could ever ask or think. He anticipates our needs. And sometimes when we ask for something, we ask for the wrong thing. But he knows what we need. And sometimes he knows that we've got to hold on to our prayers for a time so that at the very right time, he will answer it. Yes, you. Somebody Google it and find out the answer for him. It's a very rare metal. It is a rare metal. And it is more expensive than platinum. So anyway, yes. Well, of course, that is God's grace. And if you go to the book of Hebrews, he says that we should approach him at the throne of grace that we may receive grace in our time of need. So God answers according to our need. There's some great stories. Last week we talked a little bit about Ellen White, great stories from her experience about how God gave her a message for somebody. She was ready to speak it, and no, I'm gonna. It's just not there. And she waited and waited. Several months later, she was standing before a group, and she shared a message, and jaws dropped. Jaws dropped. Because she was talking about a meeting that they had the night before. And the vision she had received was months before. But God kept holding back, giving it back to her to give it for the exact time when it needed to be applied. And there are times when we pray and we think, yo, this is the time, this is the time. God says, no, not yet. And we got to hold on. And so the Rhodium rule enables us to realize that God is working for us, and so we don't give up praying. Now, another thought about prayer is that prayer does not bring God down to us. Because God knows everything, doesn't he? Before you ever ask. Before you ever ask. I remember one time, this is when I first learned this thing about God's anticipation. I mentioned to you that I worked for my dad in his office. Each of us kids had a time working with my dad. And he was trying to, he got inexpensive help, but he also was trying to instill in us about how to work and the ethic, work ethic and so on. So I was going to be working for my dad, and I knew that I was going to be running into problems. First of all, my dad was no friend to this Adventist church at the time, and I heard about that a lot when he had discussions with my mom. And secondly, I knew that he worked until usually 7 o'clock or whatever every day in his office, including Friday, when the sun would be coming, setting, and the Sabbath would be coming. And I knew I was going to run into trouble. And before I started working for him, he said, son, I'll tell you what, go home at 5 o'clock on Friday without any question. And it just blew me away that my dad, who was resistant, was mindful of that before I even asked about it. And I realized that God was providing for my needs. I didn't have to fight that. And there are so many different things that God provides our needs. We didn't even know we needed it. But then there we had it. And there are other times that he has held off. And so we need to continue to pray, because prayer does not bring him down to us, but brings us up to him. A lot of times prayer is just something that we do when we're in a jam. Kind of like kids who are away at school, the only time they call home is when they need some money, you know. And it really does a parent's heart good when they hear from their kids for other things too, right? God wants to hear from us, but he already knows what we need. So why do we need to pray? It's because it pulls us into line with him. All right, well, remember that, the Rhodium rule, okay? I'll quiz you on that sometime. All right, let's do a little deep breathing exercise here. We all need to breathe a little bit more. I've noticed that kind of when I'm sitting hunched over, I'm not breathing fully, so I need to make myself breathe a little bit better. So let's take a deep breath. Here we go. Helps you to think a little bit more as you get more oxygen to your brain. Okay, breathe out. All right, let's take another deep breath. Okay, very good. Now, why am I making you do this in the middle of the sermon besides trying to help you stay alert? Because prayer is like breathing. Yeah, some people don't breathe very deeply, and they don't pray very deeply either. So, you know, you can do these deep breathing exercises, or you can get one of those apparatuses like my mom got when she was in the hospital. You know, they use them to help you from getting pneumonia. What do they call that, Maxine? Do you know?
Inspirometer.
Okay. And you suck in as much as you can to try to get, you know, you make that little ball go up in the column, and then it drops down, and it makes you breathe a little deeper so that the fluids don't go down deep into your lungs. Well, everybody can go buy one of those if you like. But I'll tell you, my mom didn't use it. She didn't use it. I'd try to get her, and she, you know, and I'd say, oh, come on, mom. You know, try to make a little competition. She didn't want to use that. Finally, I realized that she liked playing her harmonica, and she had to breathe a little deeper. So I'd say, mom, play me something on your harmonica. And that worked. Well, I will tell you one way to guarantee that you will breathe deeper You know what that is? Yeah. Yeah. That'll do it, won't it? Or just walking briskly, okay? You may not be able to go as fast as this fella here or this lady up in the front top corner, but I will guarantee you that if you move, you will breathe. Yeah, that's the best way to get you to breathe. Go do something. Go do something. And you know what? Same thing is true of spiritual life. There are people that close themselves away in some little monastery somewhere, and they go through their ritual prayers, totally out of contact with the world. A few years ago, we went up to a monastery in Washington, D.C., and the monk that came out to greet us, very nice fellow, but it was obvious that he was out of touch with our culture, with our everything. He was trying to converse with us, but he was packed away. Didn't know what was going on in the world. Didn't know what our culture was and everything. And I felt bad for the fellow. He was very nice fellow. But he's out of touch. And we can be out of touch. If all that we do is pray, all we have is spiritual devotions, and we don't connect it to our spiritual life on the outside, we don't breathe deeply. We don't pray deeply. We've got nothing to pray about. But if you've got challenges, if you've got things that you're facing in your life, you're working with an individual. Like I told you about this young fellow that I met on the internet. And it brings out that spirit in us, that deeper breathing. We've got to, we're meeting a challenge, and it forces us to breathe spiritually deeper, to pray more deeply. So we've got to look for opportunities to share our faith, to look for ways that we face those challenges. So that prayer becomes pouring out our heart to Him. That's real prayer. Pouring our hearts out to Him. Not just a quick little breather here and there, but throughout the day, dealing with different situations. When we're stressed, when we are tempted, when we are challenged, when we are heartbroken, whatever it is that fills your heart, and you know what's filling your heart. Sometimes it's concern for somebody else. Sometimes it's your own sense of abandonment or some personal problem that you're dealing with. It's filling your heart. Sometimes it's worldly entertainment or something that just fills you. Whatever it is that's filling your heart, that's what you need to pray about. That's what you need to pray about. And you can see how each one of those things can be relieved in prayer because, okay, let's say it's a concern about a family member who has got some problem. When you take it to Jesus, you know that He can take it. He can hold it. Let's see. Keep your wants, your joys, your sorrows, your cares, and your fears before God. You cannot burden Him. You cannot weary Him. Yeah. That's not God there in the picture, but you get the idea. That's Atlas holding up the world. He carries the weight of the world on His shoulders. Susan's got a song that has those words in it. He's strong enough to bear our burdens. I remember down in Puerto Rico one time going to get some bananas with this fellow that was stout, kind of like Michael or Adrian, you know. He's just big fellow, and we went on to get bananas. Now you think of bananas just a little, they call it a little hand. Now he got this big old stalk, like 80 pounds of bananas, and I saw how he did it and everything. He cut them down. And he took one stalk of bananas, put it on this side, and then another stalk of bananas on this side. And then we went up the side of the hill like a moving machine. And I'm just like a little puppy dog running behind him, holding the machetes, you know, trying to keep up. And he's just going up the hill. those big, strong shoulders. And I thought about Jesus and how strong his shoulders are to carry the weight of whatever it is that's of concern to us. So we can take it to him. But what about the other things? What if it's that you're caught in a trap, a spiritual trap, and you don't know how to get out of it? Is that a good thing to take to him? You betcha. You know, you got a medical problem. You might be embarrassed to go to the doctor, but that's where you need to go, you know. And so you, whatever it is that fills your heart, even if it's bad stuff, he can take it. He wants to hear it. There's a hymn that I like the words to it. It says, presenting at our Father's throne our songs and our complaints. Even our complaints, whatever that we're dealing with, he can take it. And he has grace to meet our time of need. Temper problem, trouble with lust, concerns about the finances, whatever it is that's filling our hearts, we can take it to him and he can deal with it. Real prayers about real things. Now, I flashed up here a name, and I actually misspelled it. She's got an I in her name, Ethne Nunez, a lady that I met a few years ago. And she was a delightful lady. And we were working together for some fundraising or something, and I learned a little bit about her story and then found out that she had written a book that told her story. And I went by Charlotte, by the Adventist Book Center, and they had her book marked down. They've got a couple more if anybody is interested after this. But anyway, I'm not making any money off of it, so I'm not really promoting it for that reason. But she told her story, and it has to do with real prayer, and that's why I wanted to share that with you this morning. Let me give you a little bit of background on her. She was raised Roman Catholic in Ireland. She has that delightful little Irish twang in her pronunciation of words. And she was talking about her experience. And in the book, she talks about how she was in Paris, and then she came to Canada for her son to be able to go to school in Ottawa. The temperature read below 20 degrees Celsius. That's parts of Canada, right? And she had heard about some meetings that were there. I have to tell you a little bit more about her background, though. Raised Roman Catholic for 30 years, she considered herself an atheist, fiercely independent. This was a stance she had developed after a strict upbringing as a Roman Catholic. And her life was quite interesting in Paris. Now she's moved to Canada. She goes to the meetings, and there's this hulk of a fellow who is presenting the meetings. Big fellow, kind of hunched over with he looked more like a boxer than he did a preacher, with a bold New York accent. Maybe some of you can guess who this fellow might be. And he starts telling his story about gangs to God. And he presented some things on the screen, and she watched. She was curious, but she came to this fellow. She said, on this first night of the series, he tried to convince the audience that the Bible was God's love letter to people. I was not persuaded, shrugged my shoulders at every point he made. He said that God communicated with man through the Bible. Using the screen to flash text from the Bible to support his arguments, he said, God commanded, God pleaded, God spoke, etc. And at each point elicited the same indifferent shoulder-shrugging response from me. But suddenly, I was galvanized into a reaction when he said that God reasoned with man. I wanted to stand up and shout, "You're a liar!" There flashed before my eyes my experience when, as a child, I would ask for a reason for this or that in my catechism class, and I was always made to feel guilty of great sin for even daring to ask a question. Over and over, I was told never to doubt anything I learned in religion class. My parents and the nuns were of one mind. You must have blind obedience, they told me, and that was the end of the discussion. I felt that if God gave us minds to reason with, why wouldn't he allow us to ask questions? And then the verse came before her mind from Isaiah. Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. And she started to think about each part of it. And then she said in her heart, I suddenly wanted to ask God a question. God, if you have been there all along during my life of rebellion, why didn't you just swat me like a fly and destroy me when I denied you and hated your name all these years? I waited a second, she said, expecting an answer. His words came directly to my heart, were as clear as if he had spoken them to me audibly. How could I slay you? He said gently. I have died for you. This began a real prayer experience with her in her life. And she tells many, many more instances in the early part, but I want to jump ahead to a story that took place later. As she realized that she could talk to God as to a friend, she became a self-supporting missionary. And she tells about going to visit a school, and this was for children. A short time later, Tina came to my home early one morning, very distressed. She told me that her four-month-old son, Neil, was in a hospital, actually a hospital, okay, with meningitis. She had just come home from phoning the doctor, who told her to expect the end at any hour. She begged me to come and pray for Neil at the hospital, to which request I gladly consented. On the way there, I prayed silently that God would prepare my heart and that nothing would hinder our prayer of faith. I talked to Tina about faith and told her simply, faith is really believing in miracles. Since he is the creator God, there is nothing impossible for him. On arriving at the children's ward, we found little Neil lying naked on a cot, just a little skeleton, crying weakly and probably weighing no more than 5 or 6 pounds. I took him in my arms, imagining how he must have missed his mummy through all the painful injections and medicines he had to endure, and I noticed that his spine was as stiff and unyielding as a board and twisted into a Z shape. I whispered to him that his mummy loved him and that Jesus loved him, and that he was going to be fine. In the corner of the ward, a nurse was feeding a baby, and I asked if she could not try to feed this poor starving little thing. She replied that Neil couldn't swallow because of damage to his brain caused by the disease, and that they had removed the intravenous feeder as it was no longer effective. If you'd like to try, she said, there are some baby bottles right there on the tray, and if you snap the baby's lower jawbone against the upper, you might be able to get him to swallow some milk. T and I sat and doing as she suggested, and we managed to snap the little jawbone in a rhythmic fashion to simulate the action of swallowing. After about 10 minutes of this, we looked and saw that half of the 2 ounces of the milk had been consumed. Encouraged, we continued to feed Neil until the bottle was almost empty. Whispering comforting words to her little infant, his mother laid him in the cot, and he fell asleep. Then it was time to turn to the Lord for the help that only he could give. I reminded Tina of the faith factor, saying, you know, Tina, the Bible says that the prayer of faith will heal the sick. Faith is believing that God can make your baby perfectly sound in body and mind again. When you came to my house for prayer today, you were already exercising faith because you remembered what I said about Jesus, who has power to raise the sick and the dead, and even those, the dying, and even those who are dead. Do you believe this, Tina? I do believe, she responded firmly. Then let us kneel right here and just ask God to do what he said he would do. Turning to the nurse in the corner, I said, we're going to pray for the recovery of Neil. I hope this does not disturb you. Oh, no, go ahead, she replied as she continued to feed the baby. I spoke to God as I would to a friend. And I said that we must have a purpose, that he must have a purpose for Neil's life when he brought him to birth just 4 months previously. As the Creator, he knew every cell in our bodies, and therefore he could see better than any doctor exactly where little Neil's brain had been affected by the meningitis and how it could be set right. I asked him to show the doctors that he alone had power over death, and then I ended my prayer with this plea. Father, Tina and I are here to plead for the life of this child, and we come in the name of Jesus, who told us to ask anything in his name. Show the physicians here at the hospital that you are the great physician, and show his parents, Bill and Tina, that you are the God of power and love. We ask according to your will, and in Jesus' name, amen. We left little Neil, still sleeping, went towards home. Tina was comforted and felt assured that God had heard our prayer. I told her to continue petitioning God in Jesus' name, and that I would too. Because I was going overseas the very next afternoon, I was not to hear the end of the story until I returned 3 weeks later. In my travels, I never failed to pray for the pathetic little bag of bones I had seen lying on that hospital cot. While in the United States, I stayed with a doctor and his wife, and after describing Neil's condition, I asked him for his opinion. I also described the home and the family and their poverty. My medical friend shook his head and said it would be better for the child to die. Shocked to hear him say that, I argued that surely life is better than death. He said that considering the poverty in the home and the kind of brain damage that I described, it would seem to him the child would live only to be a vegetable for the rest of his life. When I returned home, I went straight to the hospital to see whether the baby was still recovering, but he was no longer there. Have there been any deaths in the last 3 weeks? I asked the receptionist a little fearfully. No, not in the infants' wards, anyway, she assured me. The child must be at home, I decided, and I went there that evening. Before I opened the gate and led to the little front path, Tina had seen me through the window and greeted me at the door as I was about to knock. She engulfed me in her arms, saying excitedly, 2 days after you left, Neil came home. Come and see him. You won't know him. And she led the way to the living room where the child was sleeping in a cot. But Tina, I asked a little fearfully, what about the brain damage? What brain damage? She replied as she threw back the covers, revealing a healthy, chubby baby who let out a strong wail on being disturbed. In his eyes of purest blue, I saw the light of keen intelligence. I felt his little spine, now perfectly straight and supple, to assure myself that God had indeed delivered Neil, perfectly sound in body and in mind. Have you thanked the Lord, Tina, for this wonderful miracle? I asked her. I never stop praising him, Ethne, and I would like you to come again and teach me the Bible as before. Bill told me I can study for myself. Well, the title of the book is Miracles Galore, but it's a book about faith and prayer and lifting up our needs to God as to a friend, because we cannot burden him. He will never grow weary. He knows the very number of hairs on our head. Those are real prayers. Now, before we do the music, I should drop back one here, because I wanted to share with you one other story. This sermon is about real prayers. This is a story that is told by Jim Nix. Jim Nix is the director at the Ellen G. White Estate, and we've talked about some of the stories in her life. This particular story that Adam's going to set up here for us is one that he told that came from his interviews with people who knew her. These were elderly people back in the 60s and 70s when he was in California. But he tells this one story, and as he switches it on, you'll see it. He's got a switch to the right setup. It's about Ellen White's prayers. Lots of different stories about different things, but this particular one is about Ellen White's prayer. Okay, I think we just about got it.
First Adventist, Seventh-day Adventist church school teacher, full-time church school teacher in California, was a lady named Mrs. Alma McKibben. Mrs. McKibben rented Ellen White's house when Ellen White went to Australia. Ellen White owned a home in Healdsburg, California. When she came back from Australia, she decided not to live in Healdsburg, but instead to buy a home over by the sanitarium, St. Helena Sanitarium. So Mrs. McKibben rented Ellen White's house. On one occasion, Mrs. McKibben said she never was a good sleeper. She couldn't sleep well at night. And on this particular occasion, she was not feeling well at all. So she traveled from Healdsburg over to the St. Helena Sanitarium, hoped to get in, but the sanitarium was full. They had no beds open. So until a bed opened up, she stayed with one of Ellen White's secretaries, Miss Sarah Peck. And Miss Peck lived in a little cottage just, well, if you're facing Elmshaven, it would be to the right. And so Mrs. McKibben said, there I was at night, I was on a couch or sofa, something right in the front room. And I could look right out the window, right up at Ellen White's house. And she said, I felt so miserable, I just didn't feel good at all. And in early hours of the morning, she said, there was a light came on in the Ellen White's writing room. And so she said, even though I knew that Sister White didn't know that I was there, just knowing that somebody else at least was awake on the place made me feel a little bit better. Now she said Ellen White, of course, believed in fresh air. So she had all of her windows there in Elmshaven open. And she said, Miss Peck also tried to practice that part of our health message. So she had her windows open. And she said, through the night air, she heard something that she had never heard before or since, anything like it. And that was Ellen White pray. She said Ellen White prayed out loud. Well, we have other records of her praying her private prayers out loud. So the story makes sense from other records that we have. But she said Mrs. White began to pray. And she said it was not our Father, it was my Father. She said it was such an earnest prayer. She said, I've never heard anything like it. Now, if you know anything about Mrs. McKibben, Mrs. McKibben was a real Bible student. In fact, she wrote some of our very earliest Bible textbooks. She was a Bible scholar. And she said, I used to read in the Bible about the burden that Isaiah or the burden that Jeremiah carried for the people of God. But she said, I never, until that evening, that night, she said, I never really understood what it was for a prophet to carry a burden for an entire people. She said, oh, we all carry burdens for our loved ones, our family members. But she said that night, as Ellen White began to pray, she said she began to implore God, earnestly pray to God, that he would stand by and help keep the leaders of this church faithful, that they would never succumb to some of the temptations that come along to deviate from the truth. And she said how she prayed that God would help the leaders of this church to remain faithful. And then she said after she had prayed earnestly on behalf of the leaders of the church, she began to pray for the ministers, the men who stand week after week in the pulpit. And she prayed most earnestly that God would keep the ministers faithful, that they would preach only truth from the pulpits of our churches. And she said, after she had prayed some time for the pastors of this church, she prayed for the teachers, the men and the women that are standing in our classrooms, and are trying to lead young people to Jesus. She said how she prayed so earnestly that God would stand by them as they are trying to preach or to teach these young people and to lead by example these young people to give their hearts to Jesus. She said, as long as I live, and she lived to be over 100 years old when she finally died, she said, I'll never forget that prayer that night there as I was waiting to get a room in the St. Lena Sanitarium, hearing Ellen White pray one-on-one when she did not know anyone was listening. This was not a public prayer. She thought she was the only one besides God that was listening, praying on behalf of this church. She said that was the first time she had just a small inkling of what it is for a prophet to carry a burden for an entire church.
That was inspiring to me to know that. And one of my favorite passages in Scripture is not about a prophet praying for us, but it's John 17 about Jesus praying for us. And he said, neither do I pray for these alone, but for those who will believe through their word. He was praying that prayer in John 17 for you and me. It gives us some idea of his intercession for us today. Jesus is still praying for us. Pray just doesn't sound quite right when you're talking to somebody who's right there with you. But prayer, that's an amazing word. It's almost like transport. When we pray to God, it is transporting us into the presence of the Creator of the universe. That is an amazing thing. And yet, it is our privilege to be able to commune with Him in prayer all through the day. We need to hear from Him, but He needs to hear from us. Our real needs, our real concerns, our real fears, our real struggles, we need to take those to Him in prayer. As we close our worship service, thinking about that, I invite you to turn to number 485 in your hymnal and sing that song that tells about this gift of prayer. 485, I Must Tell Jesus. Let's stand as we sing. I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, He kindly will help me. He ever lives, cares for His own. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. He is a kind, compassionate friend. Tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. Let us bow in prayer. Oh, my Father, our Father, we thank you that you have given us the privilege of talking to you throughout our days in prayer. When things are going well, sharing with you our delights. When we are under stress, knowing that you bear it with us. Give us strength and courage, Lord. Enrich our time with you in prayer. Help us each one to be faithful and to be always mindful of your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.